How many people have a startup? Well, about a third or so. Okay. So I'm from Intel. My name is Mark Yahiro. Thanks a lot, Matt, for inviting me, and glad to be here. So before I joined Intel, which is about 5 years ago, I had about six different startups. The last presentation was great. So a number of those definitely failed. I did not pivot on my startups. We definitely failed. So you learn a lot. Lose a lot of money, learn a lot. A lot of my credit cards were maxed out. And my wife said he's never ever going to do a startup again. But I did three more after that. So, and it's not about the money. It's about what you love. So I joined Intel because I had a chance to do something that was truly different. My first boss I had at Intel was a crazy guy. Actually, you know, he was an Israeli guy. His name was Muli Eden. He's one of the most dynamic people I've ever met. And he said, we want to change the way that people would interact with the PC. He said, look, Kinect just launched. You can dance in front of this device, and it's really cool. The iPad launched. You can actually touch it for the first time. Pretty amazing. What has the PC done in the last 10 years? Skype? Is that exciting? He goes, change the way that we interact with the PC. That was our charter. I go, OK, no problem. So we started with two people. We had a great idea. We had a passion and a vision. And this is kind of what we started with. Why is that important? So the first thing that I learned doing startups was you need to have people talk about it. I think it was a big thing in terms of talk about what you have. And what I did at startups was I got a celebrity to actually endorse my product or my service. And at Intel, we're pretty fortunate. We have a pretty good budget. So we got Jim Parsons. So, a little bit different, but you have to really get someone to talk about something because you're the ultimate spokesperson of what you do. So you want someone to actually represent that and reflect it and really scale and broadcast it out. So it's important to get that message. The vision that we had was we want to change the way that you would interact with any device. Okay, we started with PCs, but we want to go across the board. We're actually now in phablets and phones and tablets. I'll talk about drones and robots. We're doing that as well. But our goal was, if we can recreate the way that humans interact with the world and enhance that because of all the computing power that we have, we thought we would have a phenomenal platform to create innovation and to really disrupt existing businesses. That was our main high-level charter. And from Intel's perspective, we want to replace every 2D camera with a 3D camera. It's grand, but we think that's the right way to go. All right, so what we've done over the last 5 years was take a Kinect-like sensor that's similar technology, but we shrunk it down to a size of that, and that's a quarter. Okay, so now our sensors can fit in any phone, any tablet, any drone, and any robot in the world. Okay, it was really hard to do. It took a lot of people to make that happen. So, like I said, we needed to start with the hardware, but what we used to do at Intel was just develop the hardware and just imagine everyone would come. But as you know, the world has changed. So instead of just doing the hardware, we needed to provide all the key middleware technologies to allow developers and creators to do something magical. So all the SDK is free. So we provide gesture-based libraries, tracking libraries. I can track my fingers, my face, even my emotion. We have micro-expression detection, where within one frame, I could see if you're angry, if you're sad, if you're happy. It's pretty interesting. I also can see your heart rate fluctuations with your skin tone. So I know if you're actually changing your heart rate, if you're getting anxious or angry or frustrated, your heart rate usually increases. Why is that important? Learning, education, gaming. We have one developer is creating a really interesting game that if you get really frustrated, your heart rate starts to increase, or you get really scared, it's a scary game, it gets harder. It kind of freaks you out. So you got to calm yourself down, do some meditation, and then you can figure out the levels. So you can do some really crazy things in that way. So that's critical. If you look at what we're trying to do here is allow really great creative people like yourselves to look at new usages. So what does the technology do? I'll just actually show you that's the best way to do it. So just hold on. So. Now, Flo, I need your help here. Okay, so this is I can't talk to you. I'll talk loud. Let me know if this works. Hopefully this will work. All right, there we go. Has anyone seen a 3D sensor? Who's seen a 3D sensor before? Okay, you don't count. All right, so I'm going to show you raw point cloud data. So what this is a depth map. We're actually capturing the world in 3D. Sorry, I'm not going to fat finger this, so there you go. Oh, thank you, man. Oh, I just fat fingered it. Sorry, I'm going to start it again. All right, so Flo, if you can just stand there. Okay, so you see her there? The light's not so good. She's moving around. So here's the magic. So this is capturing her at 60 frames a second, and I'm rotating her, but I'm not walking around. How can I do that? That's because I'm capturing her in 3D, right? So if I want to see a texture map in color, okay, I'll know if I can get this. So now I'll colorize it. There we go. Oops, sorry about that. Oh, I did a different one, different mesh, sorry. It's my fat fingering here. Hold on, there you go. But you can see here in real time, 60 frames a second, you can actually move around and dance, there you go. But if I want to use special effects, so what, another thing that we're doing here is we're working with some of the Hollywood studios to actually do some effects in real time. So before you actually had to do this in post-processing. So if you can move around, there you go. So now this is in real time. We actually are doing this live. We're working with some of the rock and roll bands, some Hollywood studios to actually do some crazy effects that you can only do before in post-production. Okay, because I have a depth camera, I can do this in real time. So you can just imagine that I can do some crazy stuff and now I'm rotating her around and she's not even moving. Anyway, that's some stuff. So another thing that we think is disruptive is scanning people and objects. So for the first time, you can have a phone, a tablet, or even your robot, if you, once you have that, can actually walk up and scan either your environment or you. Okay, so why is that important? Well, I think it's pretty cool, but I'll show you why. So this is a third-party company we're working with. It's called Itsy's 3D. And so if I want to do a scan, so I'll do a full-body scan. I won't do the whole thing, but I'll just show you what we do. So hopefully it'll come up here. And the sensor got disconnected, so I got to restart it. So sorry about that. Hold on. I'm going to blame Windows. So.
Love demos.
Oh, I have to get rid of this one. Hold on 1 second. Sorry. My bad. There we go. It's going to probably say not no camera found, right? Hold on. Okay, I'm having problems in this one. Hold on. There we go. Hold on. Oh, sorry. Okay, there we go. It's gonna work. Maybe. All right, so here you see. Let me get this going. Full body, and if it doesn't work, I'll try the other one. Okay, so first it does, it actually does a facial recognition, make sure you're actually a real person, and I'll start to scan you, okay? So when it starts to scan, oh, I see, there we go. So what it's doing is actually scanning flow, and if I walked around you and did the whole thing, it'd be much faster, but I'll just show you, that's it, okay? So pretty quick, if I walked around, it'd be much cooler, but you get the idea. So the first thing it does is it can actually do a local preview. So let me do a local preview. And it'll actually locally process it here. If you want a much better type of image, it'll actually texture map it up in the cloud, but I'm going to show you quickly, and I'll show you what it looks like if you had more time. So it's doing it, it's processing, so I'll open the preview, and there you are, just to make sure your texture map is okay. But if I actually wanted to see what it looks like, so I took the time this week, and someone scanned me, and that's the quality you can get. So what can I do with that? Well, I can drop myself into a game, I could print myself out, I could modify myself and do some crazy stuff, but those are things that we think are truly disruptive for gaming, education, social sharing, et cetera, okay? So what else can I do with it? So why don't you show some other things. And this one?
Just get it up first.
And you need this one too, right? Is it cool or no? Pretty good? Okay. So, you know, those are some of the interesting usages, but more practical usages, and Flo is from Body Labs, if you don't know, it's a New York-based company, and we're working with them because we thought kind of what they've done was pretty interesting in terms of using our technology in a new way. So imagine if you have a tablet or a phone at home, or you're in store, and you actually want to measure something or somebody, and then she's going to measure me, so I got to stop talking.
One of the nice things is this is usually wireless. So here, we're going to capture his, I don't
Does it work? It's weird because the mouse doesn't map to it, because that's why I'm having problems. It's off. Yeah, it's off center.
Okay.
There you go.
Okay. Like clicking and it's like not at all the same.
It doesn't click. It doesn't, yeah. It's not you.
Doesn't make it any easier.
That's okay. So here's this would be the process. So the process is straightforward. You take one shot, you take another shot, third shot, we do it, and then fourth shot, right?
So we just sweep each side of the body, and then what we do with that data, if you're wearing type A clothing the way I am, we actually teach the computer to recognize human body shape and pose. So then we can take that data and say, yeah, we know that that's a body. We know the shoulder is a shoulder, the hand is a hand. And then we can actually animate it throughout the full range of human motion, or repose it, compare it to other bodies, track your body shape over time for health and fitness, and maybe most importantly, you can get really perfect and precise body measurements, which you can then use to shop online and have the complete confidence that you know you're buying the product is the right size and fit.
Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you. That's it. Good. Yeah, so I mean, I think if you look at online shopping, I think over 40% of all returns are because it doesn't fit right. Right, so we say if you can actually get your fit correctly, it'd be pretty amazing. So that's what we're excited about on that aspect. So let me put this in here real quick. Start here. Thank you. All right, sorry. Okay. Working? Not yet. All right, sorry about that. All right, hold on a second. All right, so quick one here. We went through that. I won't bore you with that. So in terms of us shipping, so the nice thing about Intel is we actually have a lot of partnerships, which is kind of good. So these are all the OEMs that are shipping RealSense technology integrated within notebooks and desktops today. Okay, these are all Windows-based products. You can actually look at the computer, and the computer can actually interact with you in a very, hopefully, new, interesting way. So those are shipping today. We're also shipping Android-based systems end of this year, and I'll talk to you about one more thing that we're going to do in a second. In terms of what we do and my group looks at are a number of new technologies. So my team is responsible for either licensing in new technology for Intel or looking at key acquisitions in terms of what's interesting out there. We also enable a lot of partners to utilize our platform. So these are all the partners that we picked and selected to develop really interesting applications. So we have something that's really interesting that we think could take advantage of a 3D sensor and our platform, let me know. So these are things that we've funded over the last 2 years, okay? So the other thing that we just announced 2 weeks ago, we have a big developers conference, our partnership with Google and Tango. Does anyone know what Tango is? Okay. So Tango's kind of cool idea that Google had a while ago. And the concept is that Google wanted to actually integrate a number of things. One is using a depth sensor with RGB data, but also tie together the IMU. IMU is basically accelerometers and gyroscopes to really enable you to look at the scene in a very interesting way. Okay, so imagine if you're walking around with a phone, I can now navigate where I don't have GPS information, et cetera. Or if I have a head-mounted VR or AR display, I can actually see that much easier because I have those. So I want to show you what it looks like. Hopefully this will work. Hold on. So. Let's see. Has anyone seen Tango before? Who has seen Tango? Hopefully this will work. Hold on. Nothing yet? Okay, I'm gonna show you a cool demo, maybe, or maybe not. Not working? No, that doesn't work. All right, hold on one more time. had problems last time. If it doesn't work, I'll move on. I'll show you later. Oh, there we go. Okay. All right, so anyone have Minecraft? Who likes Minecraft? Anyone have kids? All right. My kids love Minecraft. So let me show you this. I think it's pretty cool. So because I can actually sense the world, so what I'm doing here is it's going to actually look at this area. Okay, so now this is the real world, and I'm actually showing the virtual world. Okay, don't get sick, sorry about that. So but what I can do is actually I can make a Minecraft world in front of me, and actually I'll stack it up here, and I'll do one here, or Minecraft-like, I'm sorry. And you go, that's not so interesting, why is that cool? Well, that's cool because now I can actually go there, and I can walk through it, right? So this is because I actually have the positional information, I have depth information, and the streaming color that can do all that. Without that, you couldn't do it. So now I can actually interact with virtual and physical objects in real time, okay? So that's, I think that's pretty awesome. Anyway, so that's one thing. So what can I do with that? Is there anything that's fun with that in addition? Well, this is something that Google dreamed up with kind of our team working on something as well. So look at this. So now same thing, I'll hold it still. It's gonna track the room now. So now I'm in a virtual and physical room, and I could actually fire and shoot things. So something coming behind me. I think there's something, oh no, what's that? There you go, blows up. Okay, so those are things. You can do gaming, you can do navigation, you can do mapping, all these crazy stuff. So anyway, get the idea there, okay? So, and that's about it, hold on. And one last thing. Coming back. Yeah, we're on one. On that? Okay, thanks. Almost done there. Okay. All right, sorry about that. So the other thing I talked about was, you know, beyond the PC that we're looking at. We like drones. Anyone like drones? Robots, kind of cool stuff? So just make sure you don't build a crazy one that comes back and kills us. Anyway, so one of the things that we've done at Intel was looked at drones. Our CEO loves drones. He just invested $60 million into Unique, which is a Chinese-based drone company. The reason why we think depth sensing is so important for drones and robots is because if these are flying around or moving around in your house or by your area, especially if you have kids or pets, you don't want them to run into your kids or pets, okay? So a depth sensor has the ability to do collision avoidance. And in addition to that, we're doing a lot of machine learning algorithms to do object recognition. So that's the future, the near future. We actually have a lot of things working. And one of the tests that we actually did was we hooked up a drone with 6 depth sensors. We gave it a start position and an end position. And we stuck it in the Santa Cruz Mountains with a bunch of redwood trees to see if they would actually fly through it. So here's what happened. So. And this is a company based out of Germany. So he just started it, now he's not gonna touch the remote control, and these drones can fly on their own. Because they have the depth sensors, they're looking at objects, so they see a tree, they avoid the tree. So they know where they wanna go, and they wanna make sure they're not hitting anything, which is obviously very important. The other thing that we've looked at, a lot of different technologies, was a lot of sensors actually interact or interfere with other sensors. Our technology allows you to do multi-sensors and multi-drones or multi-robots simultaneously. And that took a long time to get to that point, too. So you get the idea of what we can do. I think it's pretty cool. So the other thing that we've done is, in addition to Windows, Android, Linux, we now support all these different platforms. So if your developers are looking at, you know, integrating or doing something creative on top of things that you're working on, those are all the things that we support. We announced the support last week as well. So pretty exciting for anyone who's in this environment. So in summary, kind of like I said before, our vision is to really take our technology. We want to make this ubiquitous. We want to make it provided to any developer out there, any maker out there that has a new idea. If you're looking at more information for when those platforms will be available, Tango, Structure SDK, all these things, check our website. We'll have announcements coming soon. That's it. Thanks.
So
PCs are shipping today. They're available today. You can go to Best Buy, Amazon.com, anywhere, and go buy them.
Yep.
The Android tablets will be coming out end of this year, early next year. Drones and robots, we have some announcements, but they'll be coming out probably end of this year or next year as well from our providers. And the Google platform should be available end of this year, early next year, too.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Awesome. Any questions?
Yeah, we'd love to help out. Absolutely. Anything we can do in terms of more of a kind of humanitarian effort, we'd love to help anything on that front. So, yeah.
Great, thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks. The trip that you showed us, can you tell us how and what was the power consumption? How much power is it and what's the
Last part, sorry?
The battery.
It depends on the battery. So usually a depth sensor takes about 800 to 1 watt, fully utilized and full, if you're always sensing. So, and then you can figure out how much battery you need per you know, usage, right? So sometimes the way that the drones are working, just to let you know, they're not always on depending on how close they are. They have a proximity sensor. They activate when it's close enough. But those are ways you have to look at for power resource. Yeah, so what we do today is there's different versions from ISVs, but our SDK is free. So there's no post-processing on that one. It's actually all locally processed. So we actually integrate everything on the hardware, and then we actually can close the loops, we'll fill the holes, so it'll be fully printable, STL, PLY, OBJ, so.
Last question is,
on
the service meter,
I'll be around.
Sorry.
Thanks, everyone.